Well, hi everyone, I'm Andrew Miller, and this is Idea Dispenser. I am a doctor. Well, almost. Hang on. Breathe in. And exhale. I am a doctor. Not this kind of doctor, obviously. I am a few steps away from being Andrew Miller, PhD. So today I thought I would talk to you about what it takes to get a doctorate degree, what a PhD really means, and what I think I got out of it. So I'm not done yet. Where I am in the process is I defended my dissertation a few days ago. But let me start way back in the beginning when I was a newly minted PhD student with a book that I found that I thought was pretty helpful. So this is the Illustrated Guide to a PhD. It's by Matt Might, and he came up with a good way to visualize the psychological experience of getting a PhD. This circle out here represents all of human knowledge. This blue circle here represents what you learned in elementary school, middle school, high school, and then the light red here is what you learned in college, and you had a major. And then the red part here is the PhD. The idea here is that over the course of a PhD, you work a long, long time until you come to the edge of human knowledge. Here is the edge of human knowledge, and then he zooms in, and you touch the edge of human knowledge, and your PhD is just this little piece here that you know that no one else before has ever known. And to you, it feels like the whole world. But you have to back out and remember that you've only made a small dent. So broadly, I thought this was actually pretty representative of my experience. I have a PhD, or will soon have a PhD, in human-centered computing, which is a program at Georgia Tech that looks at computing and people and tries to understand the ways that they're influencing each other. So what I did was, I pushed and pushed and pushed until I found a bunch of theories from psychology and sociology that said things about the ways that people might be motivated by each other to change their behavior. And I applied those in the design of a system and I tested it. So I've shown the ways in which these particular theories do and do not apply, and a number of other findings in this very small subset of human-computer interaction, human-centered computing. And I've made tiny contributions to the fields where those theories came from. But what that chart doesn't really get at fully is I actually feel like, in addition to depth, I have a sense of breadth. I feel like I understand a lot more about the ways that my little area connects to a whole bunch of different areas. So I can see now connections between my work and healthcare and education and the design of physical artifacts and the design of social computing systems. So that's not the whole world, but I feel like I can see those connections quite clearly because I've gone very deeply on one tiny issue. I don't think that's an illusion. I think that's a real sense that I've gotten to the bottom of something and I'm now the expert in something. And in being the expert, I know how interdependent it is on a whole host of other things. And that's a really cool feeling. So I started my PhD journey in 2008. I immediately noticed that the pace of PhD life is totally different from industry or even a master's degree. It took me 6 years to get my PhD, and I don't feel like that was too long. It was certainly a long time, but that's just the pace that academia moves at. And I was busy that whole time. The way that the PhD works, at least in my area, is I was doing a whole bunch of different things. So I spent a couple years studying a system that a company had built, and then I started doing my own studies, and that meant working with kids here in Atlanta and talking to them and having them do design exercises. And then I spent a year and a half or so building, designing, and then finally deploying a system. And I spent the last year or so writing, thinking, writing my dissertation, writing papers, and presenting some of my work, and I got to the point a month and a half ago where I was ready to send my dissertation off to a committee of 6 faculty. Then a few days ago, I defended that. I gave about an hour-long presentation about my work over the course of those 6 years. And they asked me questions. My parents came into town. Other students and faculty came to the meeting. Then they were all sent away, and the faculty and I got to talk about things that they would like me to change, ask me for my opinions on things. It's a really weird moment because it's the moment where I'm standing up there as the doctor and justifying that degree to them. So I'm, at that moment, not really a student anymore, but I still need to get their permission, but they want to interact with me as more of a peer. So it was a really cool moment for that reason. Like I said before, I have some stuff to change for them, and I agree. All the things they asked for are totally reasonable and would make the dissertation better. So I'd just like to finish with tips that I learned going through a PhD that I think might help you. So the first thing to note is, and this is sort of true everywhere, but especially I feel in academia, there's a sense of hiding our failures and hiding those moments when we don't know what's going on and hiding a sense that we don't belong. I think everyone will tell you that we constantly are going through cycles of, I don't know if I can do this, and even failing at it and trying again, and we go through these cycles of self-doubt. I just went through one myself, writing the dissertation. I wasn't sure if it was something I would be able to do at a certain point. I started out with 20 pages and my goal was 150. That is going to happen to you, no matter what. The other thing that I would suggest, and the thing that helped me the most, was finding a group of intellectual peers who are going to give you the social support that you need. Find those people that are going to tell you like it is and be supportive. And make sure that they're not all local to you. Find people who are in other institutions. If you go to a conference, try and make sure that you find those people who are at similar stages of the journey, but at other places. Because those are going to be the people that get you through the program and help you out later, and you can help them. Finally, it's okay to have an idea that doesn't work out. That's why it takes so long to get a PhD. Because you need that time in order to think deeply about an area and go through all of the different things that other people have tried and try some new things, and not every new thing will work. I definitely think it's worth it if you're going into it for the right reasons and if you manage to seek out those opportunities and relationships that are going to really help you. Let me know if this has been helpful to you. If you have any advice, leave a comment below, and I'll see you guys later. Press the like button, subscribe. There'll be way more videos coming. I'm trying to do them every other week. And let me know how this style is working for you, if there's any things you think I could improve on. I certainly am new to this and would love any advice or support you could give. Bye.